venu la sacrament rei, Torah. Please, Jehovah, make the Torah's word sweet in my mouth and in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name and the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Jehovah, who gave us the Torah of truth. Amen. Remain standing. We're going to be reading from Leviticus chapter 17 and verses 14 through 16, and also Hebrews chapter 9, 11 through 14 for the text that Brother Brent is going to be using. For the life of every creature, its blood is its life. Therefore, I said to the people of Israel, you are not to eat the blood of any creature, because the life of every creature is its blood. Whoever eats it will be cut off. Anyone eating an animal that dies naturally or is torn to death by wild animals, whether he is a citizen or a foreigner, is to wash his clothes, bathe himself in water. He will be unclean until evening, then he will be clean. But if he doesn't wash them or bathe his body, he will bear the consequences of his wrongdoing.
Ki nefshe kal basar damo menafsho, hu va omar lebnei Yisrael, dam kal basar lo te keluki, nefesh kal desar damo hiv kal ol kayu yikaret, ev kal nefesh asher tu kal, lebel et rafa, bazarach ub kaer ev kibes, ev kadayu verachatz, bamayim vetemeh, et ha'areb v'taher, im lo kibas u'psaro li yirchatz v'neso avono.
Hebrews chapter 9, 11 through 14. But when the Messiah appeared as the Kohen, a Kadol of the good things that are happening already, then through the greater and more perfect tent, which is not man-made, that is, it is not of this created world, he entered the holiest place once and for all. And he entered not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus setting people free forever. For if sprinkling ceremonially unclean persons with the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer restores their outward purity, then how much more the blood of the Messiah, who, through the eternal Spirit, offered himself to God as a sacrifice without blemish, will purify our conscience from works that lead to death, so that we can serve the living God.
V'chamashiach bo lichot kohen kadel latbot hi atidot abar b'tok hamashkan ham ule b'gdula ushlemet asher lo na'asa bidei adam ki ainu mihibraim chazoch kim labad b'dam sirim v'akalim ki b'dam nafsho b'ba'af Ba'am achat el ha-kodesh b'naim v'yitza kula olam. Kimdam ha-parim v'chasarayim ma'afer ha-mora asher yazech al-chet mihim yikadshem et ha-biraim avkidam ha-mashiach asher hibkraim et ha-tzmo Adonai baruach nichi iblimu ateh lepkem ma'maaseh v'ameh ladeh et Adonai.
So blessed are you, Yehovah, our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth, that everlasting life in our midst. Blessed art thou, O Yehovah, the giver of the Torah.
Baruch atah Adonai lechinyu malek ha'olam, asher natun lanu Torat emet v'chaya malam betachanu. Baruch atah Adonai noten ha'Torah.
Amen. You may be seated. And let's welcome with a hand clap Brother Brent, Sister Tanya from Oklahoma. New Covenant.
I've got this one.
Oh, that's right. You got that. That's right.
Shabbat shalom lekulam. Blessings, everybody. It is very, very good to be here with you. It's always a blessing to be with Pastor Jeff and Sister Gail. And you too. I do. You want to give me a bigger one? Thank you. And all of you. It's just an encouragement. Once again, I think the last time I was here for the anniversary. And I think one time before that, I was speaking here and then moving on to a church in Mechanicsville, and that's what's happening again. I'm going to be speaking tomorrow morning at a congregation there in Mechanicsville and then doing an early instructional Seder for them tomorrow night. So I covet your prayers and blessings for those meetings. It's always such a transition to go from this environment to that environment, but that's kind of where the Lord has me. I named my ministry Maranatha Ministries when I was in Oklahoma years ago, and I discovered that somebody already had that name. So in order to incorporate, I had to go back and change the name a little bit. So I, I needed a religious sounding word, so I stuck the word evangelistic in there because, you know, I want to serve the Lord. I want to reach people with the name of Yeshua. And so then that resulted in the initials of my ministry being M-E-M, which is Mem, which is the middle letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It's kind of the spiritual middle because there's, you know, 22 letters. You can't have an exact middle. But it's kind of considered the spiritual middle letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And I think I ended up providentially stamping a kind of a prophetic picture on my ministry because that's always where I'm at. I always find myself in the middle. I'm in the middle between the Hebrew roots movement and the church. When I'm in Israel, between the Jew and the Gentile. And sometimes I find myself in the middle of denominational disputes and things, but that's where the Lord puts me. And it's kind of awkward sometimes, but I enjoy it, and so I get to minister in a lot of different environments. For some people, that's hard. They want me to identify in just one category and one fellowship, but I'm called to the whole body of Messiah, amen? And I believe we all have a right to receive from him. I want to begin by sharing something that happened to me in Kansas City. Have any of you ever been to the International House of Prayer? Have any of you ever heard of the International House of Prayer? Now, let me give you a little background. Tanya and I grew up in the same church. My father was the pastor of the church. Tanya's father was one of the elders. And we are not from a charismatic background, okay? So when the Holy Spirit started doing things in my life years and years ago, I mean, well, first of all, he did not get my permission, and which I am very thankful for. But so the story I'm going to tell you probably is like, oh, yeah, okay, whatever. That's just the way he does. But for someone coming from my background, this is kind of weird. So I had taken a couple young men from our congregation who were, one was getting ready to go off to the military, another was getting ready to go to college his freshman year, and I just wanted to have one more kind of spiritual weekend with them. So I said, hey, let's go up to IHOP, just kind of get yourself, you know, spiritually ready and grounded for these transitions that are coming in your life. So we went up there, and I'm an aisle sitter. I don't like to be enclosed. Pastor Kenny knows this. You know, don't enclose me. And so I always sit in the aisle. And so the boys kind of the International House of Prayer is not a worship service. It's not a prayer service. It's a worship environment. And you have people on stage praising and singing and worshiping God and doing their own thing. And of course, I had to teach the young men that, you know, you don't sit there waiting for someone to tell you when to stand up and when to sit down, and you don't even have to sing along if you don't want. People pace, they walk, they study. Some of them have their, it's really cool to see the little kids come in the morning before they go to school and just have some time with the Lord, and then they leave and go and be with the Lord. Anyway, it is a spiritually saturated place. It is a very charismatic place. Like here, they will begin to sing in tongues. And so for I have to kind of help our guys get ready for that because that's just new to them. For me, it's okay because, you know, I'm in everybody's camp until they kick me out. But anyway, I had kind of gone through a spiritual dry spell. Anybody ever had those where you're kind of wondering, like, Lord, we're still good, right? I mean, because it just seems like it's just that still small voice has really been still and really been small for a while. And you're kind of wondering, hey, where are you? And so about a week before I went up there, the Lord had started kind of putting this passage from Ephesians on my heart, and I want to read it to you. It's Ephesians chapter 1, 17 and 18. Sorry, I should have had this marked. It's Paul's prayer, and he says, for this reason I too, having heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus, which exists among you and your love for all the saints, do not cease giving thanks for you while making mention of you in my prayers. And this is what he prays for them. He says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit, a ruach of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power towards us who believe. And that had just really been impacting my spirit. And so while I was sitting there and worshiping and praying, I started off to say, you know, I sat down, you kind of got to get yourself focused on what you're going to do. And I said, okay, what do I want to pray about? And then suddenly it was like the Spirit said, no, don't do that. Not your agenda today, mine. And so I just kind of thought about that scripture and I read it again, and then it was on. And so for about an hour, I'm just pacing and praying and I'm just contemplating. And here's how I am formulating this prayer in my mind. And this is the phraseology, and it was repetitious. It was over and over and over again. It was so on my heart. And I kept asking the Lord, Lord, is Ephesians 1:18 for me? Is Ephesians 1:18 for me? And the reason I was phrasing that is that the Lord has opened parts of Scripture to me and has allowed me to see some things that quite honestly some other people have missed, or to understand things in a way that has been very helpful to me personally and corporately as I've ministered, and I'm very thankful for that. But like I said, I kind of felt like I was in a dry spell, so I was asking the Lord, Lord, are you still going to do that in me? Is Ephesians 1:18 for me? Am I going to experience your voice? Am I going to hear you? Are you going to continue to teach me things that I can use to share and bless the body of Messiah in all of its flavors? And so I just kept praying this, and I'm also a pacer. So a lot of times I'll get up and I'll, as we're worshiping, I'm just praying. But none of this is happening out loud at a level that anybody else can hear. But over and over and over again, the thing in my heart and mind is, Lord, is Ephesians 1:18 for me? Is Ephesians 1:18 for me? That's how I phrased it. After a season of pacing, I came back, and for some reason, providential, I think, I decided to sit in the second seat in, leaving that first one exposed. I don't know why. Maybe my Bible was there. No, nothing was there. Because I sat down, and a couple moments later, young lady, probably mid to late 20s, sat down next to me, and she put her hand on my shoulder, and she says, excuse me, because you're really not supposed to do this. I mean, they do words of knowledge, and they have ministries and everything. But, you know, in the environment, you're kind of not supposed to do this. And she said, excuse me, I think I have a word for the Lord for you. Now, I've heard of many people going there and this happening to them, but, you know, just a little, that doesn't happen a lot in our churches, okay? So I think it would completely freak them out. But anyway, I said, well, okay. And she said, I think the Lord wants me to tell you that Ephesians 1:18 is for you. Now, you remember what I told you about where I come from. I mean, verbal answers to prayer. Are you kidding me? She says, well, does that mean anything to you? I said, no. I mean, I was weeping, I was crying. I really feel bad because I was so overwhelmed. I said, oh yes, I received that. But I never really told her how amazing what had just happened. I always feel guilty about that. But the reason I share that with you is because I've shared it with my own congregation. And I think it's a prayer, I think it's an expectation that we as the corporate body of Messiah have got to retrieve. That the Spirit of God has not stopped talking, He's not stopped teaching, He's not stopped opening the Word of God. And this is one of the things I tell my people all the time, you have not heard it all before. I mean, we could, you know, the reason we will spend eternity with the Messiah is because it will take that long for Him to show us everything we missed. And then some. And then we'll go to the next book, Exodus. I mean, this word is so powerful. I don't think we understand it when I hear people talking about it and people from all frames of reference of the body of Messiah, Messianic, Hebrew roots, Christian, whatever it is. And I get very concerned that one of the reasons we are struggling is that there are things in the Scripture that we have missed. Basic, fundamental, primary things that have been in front of us and we just didn't get it. Now, I really want to come to you this morning in humility and let you know that I didn't tell you that story so that you would suddenly prop me up in terms of your, I make no prophetic claims about myself or anything like that. The best definition of preaching I ever heard is just one beggar telling another beggar where he found bread. I mean, how exciting is that? When you're hungry and you're starving and the Lord feeds you something and then you get to go share that something with someone else. That is my frame of reference this morning. Amen? So don't take it as like, oh, let me show you what you have missed. Okay? That's not my heart. My heart is, oh my goodness, let me show you what the Father has shown me. Okay? That's my frame of reference this morning. And so I believe that He wants all of us to know. Ephesians 1:18 is for you. It's for us. And what generation has needed the spirit of wisdom and knowledge and the revelation of Him more than we need it? What nation needs that more than our country that is imploding morally and spiritually. So I'm going to invite you to just go to the throne with me one more time. And I'm going to invite you to pray a simple prayer. Lord, is Ephesians 1:18 for me? Will you come this morning and help me to receive things? And by the way, will you help me to get past those things I hear Brent say in terminology that I might not use, and get past that and get to the heart of what he's trying? Because sometimes, well, he says Jesus sometimes. And then sometimes he says Yeshua. And that's a distraction of the enemy. So all I'm asking you to do is, I'm not telling you to change your opinion about those terms. I'm asking you to not let the enemy keep you from receiving what the Spirit of God wants to show you. Will we pray? Abba, Father, we come to you, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach, in the name of Jesus, Yeshua, the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, the Anointed Head of the whole Ecclesia of God. And I pray today, Father, that in Yeshua's name you would pour forth a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, that we would turn to your scripture, and as we open in our minds and our hearts and we understand what you're saying, that ultimately it would lead us to cry out even louder than we did today, Yeshua is the Messiah, the King, the Sovereign of the living God. To your glory. And that it might produce greater acts of goodness and service in us. Open our hearts and minds and pour forth your spirit of understanding. I ask for this in Yeshua's holy name. Amen. All right, so throughout my journey, every time the Lord wants to show me something, he keeps taking me back to the beginning. And I have been here with you before, and I want to know that some of the introductory things I'm going to say, some of you have heard me say before. And in fact, for some of you, nothing I say today may be new. Maybe you just need to hear it again. I think Ephesians 1:18 was for me. I just needed to hear it again. I needed to know it. So I want to take you back. What I want to talk to you about today is the altar of God. And really, not just the altar of God, but the entire book of Leviticus. And what is that message? I remember years ago, Tanya and I were in our home congregation where we grew up, because I wasn't serving as a local pastor at that time. And the minister came in, and he started off his sermon with, how many of you like the book of Leviticus? They're all, and Tanya and I are there going, awkward. Kind of one of my favorite books. You're like, how can Leviticus be one of your favorite books? Because encoded in this book, revealed in this book, is absolutely the foundational, fundamental information you and I need to have to understand the redemptive act of Yeshua as the sacrifice for our sins and the Redeemer of our lives. Amen? So how can we scoff at it? How can we consider it boring? We need to understand it. But the story of man doesn't start with Leviticus. It starts with creation. And so Leviticus is going to be the correction of whatever happened to us after our fallen creation. So in order to understand how the altar is going to meet our needs, we kind of have to know how we were made and how we got broke. So I want to start there, and I want to remind you that when the Lord created us, we were created by Him, and we were created for Him. I'm always telling our young people, because the Lord, I don't know what sin I committed, but the Lord has put me back in youth ministry with junior high kids. And I'm like, what did I do? I love them. I love them. I was praying for them, even this service this morning. They're at a youth conference in Kansas City this weekend. You know, I love these kids, but I'm always trying to get them to understand that how they were created and how precious and valuable, you know, they are to God. We were created by Him. We were created for Him. And I'm always saying, we were created by the will of God that became the Word of God. And it's not possible for us to live our lives as byproducts of the will of God and the Word of God, which means everything, our basic DNA, was a byproduct of His life and His creation. It is impossible to be a creation of the will and Word of God and then live our lives outside the context of the will and the Word of God and wonder why we can't seem to make this life work for us. I mean, this is just common sense. Every part of my being, I know I've got the sin nature, but I also have the original creation of the image of God, and that was by the will and the word of God. You notice, even before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2, men were expected to serve God. The Yetzirah, the evil inclination, was not an excuse because the image of God was still there. So, one of the things I want to share with you this morning is about how mankind was created. And to remember that this whole world was created in the image of God. I think when I was here and I taught on the book of Revelation, we looked at the throne of God and how the throne of God is literally the blueprint for everything you and I know as time and distance and creation. It's all a part of His image. But there's a few things, and I know that this is going to be review for you. But I want to remind you what is said in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. It says, "Then the Lord God formed man of the dust of the earth, or the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man, Adam, became a living being." By the way, that's theology. Now, man's theology is look at the scripture and try to make a really smart-sounding sentence about what he just read, and then say, that's my theology. God's theology is, watch what I did, pay attention to how I did it, and listen to what I said about you. That's theology. It's not this person created this system. If you want theology, you've got to start in Genesis. Because everything that's going to come from there is going to be a byproduct of that. So he forms us from the dust of the earth. The Hebrew there is Adma. And so he forms Adam from Adma. And by the way, from this root word, we also get Edom, we also get Adom, which means red. So when Adam was created from the ground, which also can mean red, he was created from the land of the red man, which is what Oklahoma means. he kind of butchered my revelation there, so I'm just kidding. That's literally what Oklahoma, it's a Choctaw word, I believe, and Oklahoma means land of the red man. So we call Oklahoma West Jerusalem. Anyway, and by the way, Yeshua's return is sooner now than when we first believed. So I'm just saying. All right. Y'all need to write that one down. Anyway, Adam is created from Adma, the ground. And then God breathes in him the breath of life, the Ruach. And he becomes a Nefesh Hayah, a living being. And we've talked about this before as well. But I also want you to see that from the Hebrew Adma, Adam, when that breath is breathed into us, what is the carrier of that breath? Dam, the blood. So he created us with a form, a physical form, to carry and receive his life. Now this is, you know, if you were looking for a title for my message today, it's simply this: life is in the blood. Amen? But it doesn't belong to you. And we'll get there. So when he created us as Nefesh Hayah, living beings, I love the fact that these two words can be translated as life appetites. God created us, he said, be fruitful and multiply, and then he told us what we could eat, okay, to replenish that life. And so God gave us two appetites that one would replenish and preserve our life. So this Hebrew word nefesh, when Job is being confronted by God, God says, "Can you satisfy the nefesh of the young lions?" What's he talking about? The hunger. Your life is your connection to this world, your appetite. And God said, "I've created this so that you can preserve and prolong your life." I love that because I know a little bit about appetite. I always tell people, I know that there's some terms that Paul uses that can be translated as sin nature, but I don't like that word. And I don't like the English of it because here's what I want the body of Messiah to know. Sin is not natural. Amen? Sin is the unnatural. We were not created in the image of sin. We were created in the image of holiness. Sin is the aberration. Sin is the infection. Sin is the cancer. So I don't like calling it the sin nature because too many people in the body of Messiah of all flavors will use it as a fallback and say, "Well, I'm only human." Well, I'm sorry, even before the giving of the Messiah and the giving of the Spirit, God still expected you to rise above that. And the altar was one of the ways he used to let you do that. We'll get there. The other appetite, by the way, this is why we fast at Yom Kippur, because without the altar, the scripture says you will afflict your nefesh, your soul. So how do you go from afflicting your nefesh, your soul, to, well, you ought to fast? Because your nefesh is your appetite. And if you want to say to the Father, I would rather have a hunger for you and satisfy you than satisfy my flesh, what do? You fast. All right? Now, this is essential. Remember this. This is foundational before we get to the altar. He also created with an appetite to procreate and pass on his life within us. Now, this is kind of a weird illustration, and I know we may have some young ones in here, so parents, there are going to be a couple things you may have to go home and explain. But in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 24, and it's not a happy verse. Israel is likened to a donkey that's in heat, that sniffs the air. Jeremiah is describing one of their fallen states. And they sniff the air looking for another donkey in heat to satisfy its nefesh, its desire. And the idea is that God created us with this life appetite, created this world that would work in perfect harmony with us to produce that which we would need to prolong our life, but he also created with us the capacity through his life within us to procreate and pass on that life that he has given within us. But the connection I want you to see is that appetite, that life procreation appetite, is also part of this definition of who we are. And by the way, that is our blessing. He blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. One of the things I've been teaching here lately is a blessing is that which leads to fullness and completion in the Messiah. You want to bless somebody, you do something. God blesses us with something that's going to bring us to completion and is going to bring us to life. What is a curse? A thing that brings us to frustration and ultimately death. And I'm always telling our people, don't be a curse in somebody else's life. Don't be speaking things that affect the way they see themselves, because you're distracting them from the blessing, the call to life. Don't do that. The Bible says that God created good, he created evil. What do you mean? Well, if there's up, there's down. If there's right, there's left. If there's north, there's south. If there's good, there's evil. He didn't create it for you to go there. He created it so that you could choose not to go there. Evil sown in another person's life is trying to get them to move away from the good, the blessing. So this is our blessing. He created a world which perfectly is a picture of his throne and is created for us to live and to pass on his life. So what happened? Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Eve looks at the Etz Nechmad, this beautiful tree, pleasant to the eyes, and she says, and you know what? You know this is true. Have you ever just gone to the store and you're going through the produce section and you see the fruit? How many times have you just walked right on past and went, nope? You just looked in the bin and you saw the condition of the fruit and you went, uh-uh, moving on. You know, you went and thumped that avocado, nope, rock hard, moving on. How many times have you gone through the produce section and you look in that bin and you see that fruit and you go, whoa. Got to have me some of that. And you go home with way more oranges than you can possibly consume before they go bad. Why? Your eyes told you everything. That fruit, you knew. You just knew by looking at it. Its color, everything about it. What do you think the fruit looked like in the Garden of Eden? And here's this tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and she looks at it, It wasn't easy to pass by because it had all of those outward markings that said, this is going to be good. And let me tell you something. There's no doubt in my mind, that's probably the best tasting fruit she ever had for about 10 seconds. But remember, she gave some to Adam. She didn't go, ooh. She said, Adam. With the life that was within her, she used her life to doubt God And to express that, the manifestation of that doubt was to eat and satisfy her appetite in a manner in which God had said, don't do it. Now remember how we were created. Sin comes into the world through the corruption of our appetites. And at that moment, the one who had Yotzer formed us from the dust of the ground, now we formed Yetzer Ra. We formed a new living appetite in our flesh, the sin appetite, the evil appetite. And I like that better than sin nature. Because I always tell people, hunger's not a concept, right? If hunger was a concept, I could just tell myself, stop being hungry, and I wouldn't look like this. If you think hunger is a concept, you know, you can say, well, I'm going to go on a diet. I'm just going to tell myself I'm not hungry. Okay. That'll work for you for a couple days. And then hunger's going to say, I don't know if you understand this or not, but I'm not a concept. Feed me. You don't believe it? Go to the desert and say, I don't need to take water. I'm just going to walk off across the Negev desert. I don't need water. I can just will myself to not be thirsty. Okay, we'll pick your carcass up in a few days, but okay. Body of Messiah, can you will yourself not to be hungry? Can you will your appetites to not do what they were created to do? No, you cannot. Why do you think you can do it with sin? Why do you think your victory over sin is simply a matter of your will? Now, overcoming sin is a matter of will. You have to make a choice, just like with our other appetites. But a lot of people spend their life in frustration, never getting free from the power of sin in their life, because they treat it like a concept. And that's why I don't like sin nature, because it's such a weird word. I understand appetite. But God does something to help us overcome that appetite. He puts the Ruach HaKodesh within us, the spirit of His holiness. We always say Holy Spirit. Ruach HaKodesh is really spirit of holiness. In Hebrew, Ruach HaKodesh is what's called a construct form. You put these two nouns together, and the of the possession is replied. Ruach HaKodesh is not just the Holy Spirit. It's not just that the Spirit is holy. It's the spirit of holiness, His holiness. And He puts His holiness within us, and our spirit then can say to our flesh, you're not my master anymore, and now it can begin to create within us a hunger for righteousness. And I can tell my flesh, you're not in charge anymore. Now I have a fighting chance. But I want you to notice that the punishment fit the crime. I know we've talked about this, but this is essential foundational stuff before we get to Leviticus. Because once you understand this, the altar is going to make perfect sense. And I want to submit to you that for most Christians and theologians, it does not make sense at all. All right? So we give into this natural appetite, and now we have to go out into the world. And suddenly, the world is put under a curse. We have a sin appetite, and it no longer has the desire to feed us. See the problem? We have brought a curse onto what was supposed to be our blessing. All because of our appetite and how we choose to feed it. So turn with me to the book of Leviticus. Today is... You know, when I decided I wanted to teach on this, I want to be real honest. I didn't realize that if you're following the annual plan of the Torah reading, today is the first day we would be reading from Vayikra, which means, and He called. And boy, if the Lord would do anything today, I would hope that you would hear Him calling you. So let me just tell you why what we're about to share is so important. I was in a class sometime back. And I had heard a man, a seminarian, doctoral degreed man, who loves Israel, loves the Hebrew language, make this statement to a classroom full of seminarians: God borrowed the altar from the pagans because that's all Israel understood. And all God's people said, uh-uh. But you know what? All these international students were sitting there going, oh, okay. That sounds logical. They'd been in Egypt for a couple hundred years. That's all they knew. And I sat there and I about came unglued. God does not borrow from the pagans. Amen? I mean, It is Satan, the enemy, who has not a creative bone in his body. I love when I'm teaching Revelation and it talks about how they begin to worship the beast and they sing, "Who is like the beast?" Are you kidding me? You can't even write your own music. Mika moka baeli madonai. Mika moka neder bakodesh. They're singing that song in the synagogues all over the world today. Who is like the Lord? Satan can't even write his own music. Who is like the beast? Everybody. Not original. I was about to say, where was I? I did that in my home church and someone yelled out, "And in conclusion." So the problem was I was in my introduction. So I share that story, not to demean Matt, because I love him with my whole heart. I really genuinely do, and love some things that he's shared and taught me. But if a man at that level of education and interaction with rabbinic thought and Hebraic thought, and I mean, could say such a thing, that's kind of a terrifying picture, isn't it? Meanwhile, out in the body of Christ, especially in the church, you have pastors saying, "Have you got get a load of that book called Leviticus? What was that all about?" Do you understand why my passion is so strong? If that's the message we're hearing out there, we're in trouble. We need a spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him so that we can put this whole thing together and stop chopping it up and making it look silly. So this is what I want you to do. Turn with me to Leviticus chapter 1. And you know that this book is named after Leah's son, Levi. She names him Levi because he says, "Now my husband will become attached to me." So isn't that interesting? Because this is a book that is named after a boy whose mother named him this because she desired to be attached to her husband. This is a book that is going to teach those of us who have discerning ears, who want to become cleaved unto and attached to our Heavenly Father, this is going to be the beginning of how we restore what happened in Eden. Okay? Amen? Are you with me? Very cool. Now, today I want you to understand something about the book of, well, all of the Bible. Not only, by the way, what time are we supposed to be done? 3? Yeah. You better pray for me tomorrow morning, because I've got to do this message twice in 30 minutes in each slot. So, yeah, you're getting the big version. They're getting... Mm-hmm. So here's what I want to show. Even the way the books of the Bible are put together are supernaturally, providentially born. And as the Lord took me back to Leviticus, He began to show me something. And one of the things He began to show me is that if you think of the book of Leviticus as a wheel, and there is a central hub, a spoke, and every subject that's going to come off of that spoke is ultimately feeding into that one central subject, and that central subject is simply this: life is in the blood. Say it with me. Life is in the blood. If you understand that blood is the central subject of that book, then you will begin to understand the kind of odd subjects that come up in that. If you will then say, "Well, wait a minute, if this book is about blood, then what's going on here?" And you start doing research, and pretty soon you're going to go, "Oh, there I am back at the hub again." And so I want you to keep that in mind. Very quickly, Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 says, "Then the Lord called to Moshe and spoke to him from the tent of meeting, saying, Speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, When any man of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of animals from the herd or the flock. If his offering is a burnt offering from the herd, he shall offer a male without defect." And I'm going to stop right there because you have read Leviticus 1 and you know it gets very repetitious. He describes the bringing of a bull, calf, goats, etc. So here's a few things I want you to know about these offerings, chapters 1 through 7. You know this because you have a good teacher. They're all voluntary. They're all voluntary. Listen, I got all the way through Bible college and served for many, many years before I ever knew that. So my attitude when I looked at the book of Leviticus was like, "Oh, look at all these things they had to do." They didn't have to do one of them. You say, "Well, what about a sin offering?" Nope. God isn't looking for anybody to bring a sin offering that isn't genuinely repentant. There's no offering that, you know, you just don't go kill an animal and walk away going, whew, scot-free. That's not what he's looking for. So these are all voluntary offerings. So why would you bring them? Well, before I get to that, let me say this. Everybody is capable of bringing a sacrifice. This is what we learn from these sacrifices. One, they're all voluntary. Two, everybody's capable. How do I know? Because he starts with a bull and he ends up with two turtle doves. The poorest of the poor can purchase the doves and come and offer a sacrifice. So the altar of God was never exclusive, right? I mean, he designed, the altar screams out, I desire all men to come to the knowledge of me because you can bring your sacrifice. So what happened with the sacrifices? Well, they had five sacrifices, burnt offerings, meal offerings, peace offerings, sin offerings, for unintentional or unknown sin. And I love that one. Why would anybody want to offer a sacrifice for a sin they don't even know if they committed or not? Why would God even give you that kind of an opportunity? Because the Lord's looking for the person's heart who says, you know what, in this fallen flesh, I have failed even when I thought I didn't. Tanya and I follow biblical kosher. She went to a ladies' retreat one weekend. Left me by myself at a Walmart grocery by myself. And she knows that if she says, if I call her and say, I'll stop by the store and get something to eat, there's a 95% probability we're having hot dogs that night. Usually Hebrew National, so I don't have to worry about it. But on the day that I went, they didn't have any. So I started reading labels, you know, all beef, you know, and I'm also looking to see, you know, the casings and all that kind of stuff. I'm doing the best I can. And I picked them up, and I'm picking them up. And I finally said, well, I think this one's okay. And I reached and grabbed it. Went home, and you want to talk about appetite? I opened that pack. Man, I made some hot dogs. By the time she got home from the weekend, there was only three left. And so we were just kind of nuking them a couple. I nuked a couple. She was going to eat one. And I'd already gone in the living room. We were just going to sit down. And then I heard this, ah! Brent, I said, what? These are pork hot dogs. I said, no, I read the label. She walks out. I mean, it's not small either. Pork hot dogs. I'm like, oh. I'm sorry, what? And all God's people said, oops. Wasn't intentional. The Father is looking for people who are looking for Him. And the people who are looking for Him understand the fallen nature of their flesh, and they know the sins they've committed, but there's sins and things they've done out there. Oh, you are so precious. Thank you. I can't go on. I can't go on. That's my Elvis, okay? I'll hear about that one from my wife. Anyway, He's looking for the heart that says, you know what? I want to meet with you, Lord, at your table. Oh, my goodness. I shall preach over here. You are now my... You are now my wife's hero. Man, do you ever hear that scream from the back room? You go back there, little teeny thing. It's not even bigger than a tick. It's on the ceiling. I don't even see how she saw it. She walks out, there's a spider on the ceiling. I'm like, how do you even see those things? Anyway, we're going to be here all day. He is looking for people who are looking for Him, who are honest enough to understand that we are in this fallen world, we are falling all the time, even when we don't know it. And I want to let you know, if you think you keep kosher, you are kidding yourself. I mean, God loves your effort and good for you, but if you think you're going to get to the pearly gates and you want them to check your pure kosher card, you are in trouble. Can anybody say, praise the Lord for grace? I told my mom, don't be making baked beans with pork in them. She said, I didn't. Before she died, we went to the store and she said, well, we need to get some pork and beans. I said, no, Mom, we don't. You've been telling me all these years. I've had kosher kids over to my house. You told me they weren't in there. She goes, well, honey, I take it out. It's like, Mom! You know, you're standing in the middle of a grocery store, and at that moment, you know you need Yeshua more than you ever realized. Burnt offerings. So what are these offerings? Let's say you go on a trip and God blesses you and you have great success and you come home and you want to celebrate because you know providentially he's had your back. And so you take an animal, you want to do an olah, an elevation sacrifice. What does that elevation mean? What is actually being elevated? Your nefesh. Your soul. You are saying to God, I want to come to your table and say to you, I do not want to live my life according to the corruption of my flesh appetites. I want to dine with you. I want to elevate myself. I want to be restored to fellowship. You see, the altar of God is the table of God. And Leviticus is God's way of telling you, these are the animals that are acceptable on my altar. This is the manner. And by the way, it doesn't matter which animal you bring. Unless you can afford a bull and you bring two turtle doves, now we got a problem. That's a problem. But the other is not a problem. Because you bring it this way, this day, and you're saying to God, and then you take the meat from the altar, the blood and the fat remain on the altar because life is in the blood and it doesn't belong to you. It belongs to God. That's his portion. But you put the meat on the altar, you take it home, you call your people together, and you share this feast. I was just preaching up in Missouri, and a lady came up to me after one of the messages. I was talking about this, and she asked a brilliant question. She thought it was a dumb question. It was a brilliant question. She said, okay, but I just don't understand this pleasing aroma thing. I said, what do you mean? There's an Olive Garden and an Outback Steakhouse right beside each other in Oklahoma City. And sometimes we'll be headed to Olive Garden, and I'll get out of that car, and I'm being tempted to do something other than the Olive Garden. Man, it gets me. You know what I'm talking about. She said, but that would stink. And I couldn't understand, like, what are you talking about? And then it hit me. Now, some of you are old enough to remember. Remember the little flannel graph that your Sunday school teacher used to, you know? It lied to you. Because every time you saw that flannel graph and you saw the altar, the animal was completely on the altar. Hair, bone, flesh. Yeah, that would stink. And I was like, beautiful question. Because she was indicating with what she had been taught about the altar, the very terminology that the New Covenant writers use makes no sense to her. But when you understand that the altar was kind of like a barbecue where the priest would take the meat and you would take the meat, and the only time you couldn't take your portion of the meat to go home and eat was when you were sinned, because you can't go, hey, let's have a party, I sinned. I think I might have. No. This is the table of God. But here's what you have to understand. It doesn't matter if you bring the right animal on the right day for the right reasons. If you do not understand that the blood and fat do not belong to you, you have completely missed the point of the altar. Because there is no type of sacrifice where the blood and the fat will ever belong to you. Because life is in the blood and it doesn't belong to you. All right? The Bible defines life as your nefesh. And life is in the blood. Now, in Leviticus, it says, if any man who wants to bring an offering, and I love this because the Hebrew word bring and the noun offering, the verb to bring and the noun, the offering, are the same word. They're the same root. If you want to draw near, from the word korban, you can draw near with your draw near offering. I mean, the terminology can't make the purpose of coming any clearer than that. Anybody that wants to draw near to me may do so by bringing me a draw near, a korban offering. For those who are seated in the back, we are not korov. I'm not picking on you. I'm glad you're there because it works out for the illustration. We're not near. Pastor Kenny and I are near. Karov. Korban. Same word, same root. And so he says, if you want to draw near, now remember, what happened to us after we ate? We were not drawn near, we were put out. We were sent away. We went into exile. And now God has established this place where he says, if you want to draw near, this is how you do it. You come to me with the blood of the sacrifice, and you recognize that in giving it to me, you are saying, I know the only way I can have fellowship with you is that if I recognize that life is in the blood and it doesn't belong to me. I don't have the right to commit sin, intentional, unintentional, or otherwise. The life that's within me is a gift from you. And in the same way we used the satisfaction of our appetite to show God we don't trust him and we're put away, now God says, let me create a table, a place for you where you can say, I want to elevate. I want to draw. Is this helping? Is this simplifying a little bit the altar? I remember years ago I was in a Sunday school class and a good friend of mine was reading from a church curriculum. So it wasn't, I'm not blaming him. He didn't say it. He was just reading the curriculum. And it described the altar as the bloody ritual system. And I just came unglued. I stopped being nice that day. Because I'm not going to sit there and listen to someone demean the very thing that God was using to prepare us to understand what he was going to do with his son. For those who would want to draw near unto him. By the way, if you go into the ancient Near East and you look at all of the other pagan religions, in all of those other pagan religions, the blood and the fatty portions are not specifically limited to the deity, meaning the people consume them. Ever heard of a little thing called meat sacrificed to idols? It's got blood in it. And the blood was offered to demons. And that's why he says, even in the last book of the New Covenant, you will not eat meat sacrificed to idols. You can't eat at the table of demons and at my table. So here's this picture. The worship draws near to God for the restoration of intimacy and fellowship. So this is the place God says, this is how you're going to learn to draw near to me. And then we jump over to Leviticus chapter 11, and suddenly we get this chapter about the animals, the laws of kosher. Now this makes perfect sense if you understand what the actual subject is. What has God just been teaching us? This is my table, and this is what is acceptable on my table, and the one thing that when you come to this table that you have to understand is the blood and the fatty portions are not yours because life is in the blood. Now that I've told you what is acceptable on my table, I'm going to tell you what's acceptable on yours. Because when you leave this place, our relationship is not just about what you did at this place, it's about what you do at your place. You can't just draw near to him on Shabbat or on the first day of the week or if you're really holy, Wednesday night Bible study. You can't do that. If it's not in the home, it's not in the heart. Ooh, write that down. That was from him. If it's not in the home, it's not in the heart. What happens here is important, but what happens there is even more important. So he tells us, well, and here's what he's going to do. Remember the fruit? How you could look at that fruit and you just knew? Well, Lord, how are we going to know what's clean and unclean? He says, I'm going to give you some exterior descriptions that will explain to you some interior realities. And science has now helped us understand what some of those interior realities are. Now, some of them we don't need science because it's obvious. Carnivorous animals. Carnivorous animals tear the flesh and eat the blood. If life is in the blood and I can't eat it, and then the scripture over and over and over again, right out of the ark, you know, God tells Noah, life's in the blood, you shall not consume it, you will not eat it, you will not shed it, it's not yours. All right? And so, carnivorous animals, if it eats the blood, you eat the blood. That's a no-no. Life is in the blood. I don't eat carnivorous animals, not because I'm in bondage, but because I'm in freedom. Life is in the blood, and it doesn't belong to me. You say, well, okay, Brent, those are kind of obvious. But what about some of these other animals that he says not to eat? And once I understood that the issue is blood, then all of them made sense. Because what you find out when you start looking at the unclean animals is that their digestive system handles the impurities and blood differently. All the impurities are not cleansed. The blood is cleansing some of that stuff in the digestive system. In those animals, it's not. It's being absorbed in the fat. That's why you cannot eat those animals and that fat, because it's got blood in it, and life is in the blood, and it doesn't belong to you. It doesn't belong to me. And I'm suddenly looking at this, I'm going, oh, well, that's not a burden. I mean, now I have some knowledge because I've paid attention to the context of the book. The verse we read in Leviticus, we actually missed a couple that I want to read. Beginning in verse 10, it says, any man from the house of Israel or from the aliens who sojourn among them. What does that mean? People who bind themselves to Israel and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Who eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood by reason of the life that makes atonement. Therefore I said to the sons of Israel, no person among you may eat blood, nor may an alien who sojourns among you eat blood. So when any man from the sons of Israel or from among the aliens who sojourns among them is hunting, catches a beast, a bird, or which may be eaten, meaning it's clean, he shall pour out its blood, and it will cover the earth. Meaning, even if you're out hunting and you kill a clean animal, you still have to recognize the sanctity of the blood. They have to dig a hole. They have to bury it. I get on, you know, we're kind of a country area. I have to get on my guys all the time because we have hunters, and I'm not against hunting. But don't you dare don't take your children, your sons and daughters out and have them drink the blood of the animal you just killed. Life is in the blood, and it doesn't belong to you. It's an abomination. It's the thing that says to God, I'll do what with my life. May I? Do you remember the word for blood? Dom? I'll do with my life whatever I well please. What is damnation? The judgment on a life that used the blood to do whatever it wanted. God says you won't do it. And then he says, and I love this, I've given my portion as an atonement for you. Now, this is where we need to see this amazing draw near moment. God says, I've created a place where you can draw near with your draw near offering. And the way you testify that you understand I am the sovereign of life is you render to me my portion, and I will use my portion to cover the shame of your nakedness. Remember what happened in Eden? God had to provide an atonement, a covering. And all of that makes perfect sense. And then Leviticus takes a weird turn. We no sooner get done with chapter 17, and then verse 18, he says, then the Lord spoke to Moshe, saying, speak to the sons of Israel, and say to them, I am the Lord your God. You shall not do what is done in the land of Egypt where you live, nor are you to do what is done in the land of Canaan where I am bringing you. You shall not walk in their statutes. You are to perform my judgments and keep my statutes to live according with them. I am the Lord your God, so you shall keep my statutes and my judgments, by which a man may live if he does them. What has he just been teaching them about how to live? Respect the blood. Come to the altar as the antithesis of what we did in Eden. Is the altar making more sense? It is the exact opposite of what we did in Eden. So now I want to talk to you about what I call the other side of the altar. Because he goes on, none of you shall approach any blood relative of his to uncover nakedness. I am the Lord. And then he begins to list in chapter 18 all of the immoral sexual relations that are forbidden. And the very first one is bloodlines. Did you hear what he said? We can draw near with a draw near offering, and we will be elevated beyond the carnality of our flesh, and he will cover us. But there's another way to live. You will not draw near to someone that I have said is not for you, to uncover nakedness, a synonym for that which is sexually forbidden. Do you see the opposite? You see, there are two ways that we can live in this world. We can draw near to God, recognizing our life is not our own and knowing that He will cover us if we recognize that. Or we can choose to satisfy the carnality of our fallen appetite and use our body to commit acts of sinfulness, saying to God, life is my own and I'll use it however I please. And sexual immorality, and again, I know there's young ones, so I'll be as vague as I can, but sexual intimacy is not possible without blood. It is a byproduct of blood. And he says, you will not arouse, you will not inflame, you will not burn with passion, you will not use my life to commit immorality. You will not use my life to commit idolatry. You will not use my life to sin against the blood. You already did that, and it put the whole world under a curse. Those are your options. How does God know your heart? What you do with the blood. Is this helping at all? Please, because I know this is a lot. The word you shall not uncover is the same Hebrew word that is used for the dispersion, the exile, captivity. Those things lead to bondage. And you look at our society that has been corrupted by a blood lust. Do you know why our culture loves vampires? You ever thought about what a vampire is? Antichrist. It's an abomination. The vampire is not a living being. He has existence, but he has no life. And he selfishly takes the life from the living to preserve his actually non-existing life. I mean, if you wanted to create a monster that was the exact opposite of the Messiah, this is what that monster would look like, because Yeshua gave his life so that we could live. So he doesn't consume the life of somebody else. He gives his life so they can live. He died so we can live. Now you understand why the world is infatuated with vampires and zombies and all this nonsense? It's an abomination. He said, you will not consume blood. And I have a feeling he meant with these two. Now, let me get away from the stage. I'm not perfect in all those ways. I'm mortified sometimes. We went to a movie one time, and it was a superhero movie. And I was mortified that within the first 5 minutes of the movie, the good guy killed, I mean, just dozens and dozens of people. I was like, okay, I know they're supposed to be bad people, but they're still living people. We are a nation. Turn on the news, and what are you beginning to hear about? Demon possession. Why? Demons are attracted to blood. That's why demons are attracted to idolatry. That's why he says, life is in the blood. Doesn't belong to you. Last summer at Camp Yeshua, I was teaching the boys, guys, life is in the blood. It doesn't belong to you. You can't treat these young women this way, because you're literally walking out the spirit of Antichrist when you do that. You can't be a vampire. You can't consume somebody else's life for your own benefit. See the juxtaposition. I'm drawing to a close. One approaches the God at the altar to preserve life. The other approaches a corrupted soul to perverse its life. One seeks to establish relationship with the sanctity of the blood. The other seeks to establish relationship with the defilement of it. One seeks to have the shame and nakedness of sin covered by God. The other seeks to expose nakedness and shame while pretending to be God. One is drawn near and cherished. The other is dispersed and cut off. One is atoned and the other is abandoned. And each one's destiny is determined by what they did with the blood. The book of Leviticus reveals that the holiness of life is in the blood. I've been in the Messianic movement, Hebraic roots movement. I've seen it evolve and I've seen it devolve. And one of the things that I'm seeing in certain segments is we no longer cherish the Messiah. We have a whole generation of kids who, okay, I mean, you know, but let me tell you something about this. This is not about dancing on Shabbat. This is the story of how the Messiah, how God created this world, knew we would fall, knew we would want to be drawn near, and knew that we would not be able to approach him without a sacrifice. When Yeshua says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father, may I paraphrase, no man draws near to me except through Christ. He's using sacrifice terminology. If you want, he's saying, if you want to draw near to the Father, you can't do it without me. But in many versions of the Messianic movement, the Messiah is in the back seat. And I love Moses, and I love the revelation he taught, but Moses did not shed his blood for me. Amen? He can teach me what I need to know about God wanting, creating an opportunity for me to draw near, but when I draw near, I've got nothing. If I don't have the blood of the sacrifice. And Christ has poured out his blood and given his flesh for the redemption of mine. And how will I know that I will be welcomed into his presence? Will it be because my kosher card is perfect? No. Will it be because I have perfect attendance on Shabbat or the first day of the week or at all the holy festivals? No. He's going to look at us and he's going to know those who belong to him, because the only ones he pours forth the Ruach HaKodesh into to restore and renew life are those that knew I cannot draw near to God without the blood of the sacrifice of his perfect Son. The Christ, the Messiah, if he doesn't get back in first place in the body of Christ, in the Messianic movement, in the Hebrew, whatever you want to call it, we're not keeping Torah. If I teach you about the altar and I don't teach you about the cross, I have violated the Torah. Now I close with this last thing. Well, that's well and good, Brent, but Yeshua died on a tree, not an altar. And I've shared this with you before, but I just want to remind you of it. I asked the Lord, well, why is that? And the Spirit just whispered to me one night, because my children did not break faith with me at the foot of an altar. They broke faith with me at the foot of a tree, where we reached out and we saw the beauty of that fruit and the life of that tree. And we took it. Eve believed the lie. And we took our life in our own hands. And the Father said, you want to judge me by a tree? Okay. I'll give you a tree that will reveal who I am. But it's not going to be an etz nechmad. It's not going to be a beautiful tree that you will be drawn to. It's going to be the bin you want to go, ooh, not going there. Because it's not a living tree. It's a death tree. And he takes the first fruits of his own holiness, his son, and he allows humanity to nail him to that tree. And then he says to our hearts, now who's holding out on whom? And what are you going to do with the blood of the sacrifice? The first tree we were told, don't touch, don't taste, don't eat. In the day you do, you die. At the second tree, he says, take, eat, and live. He designed an altar to bring us to the tree so that we could show the Father we want to be elevated above this nightmare that we created, so that we can draw near to him. And as a reward for recognizing his sovereignty of life, he fills us with the Ruach HaKodesh. Now, I know that until he comes, there's going to be a war. Because this flesh still likes to eat food and sin. It wants what it wants. But the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit of Holiness, begins to recreate my appetites in the image of God so that I can hunger and thirst for righteousness. And I can say to my old dead flesh, you may not have got the memo, but you ain't my boss no more. I'm being recreated in the image, a deposit of his life. By the way, remember that Abram, I'll close with this, Avram, when he believed God, God changed his name. Remember how he did it? He put the Hebrew letter He in the middle of his name. Everybody put your hand in front of your mouth, say He. What'd you feel? Your breath. The spiritual meaning of the letter He is it's the breath letter. So the sages say it represents the Holy Spirit. A one-letter prophecy about what God would do for the faithful descendants of Abraham. But when he does that, the promise he immediately makes is, you're going to have a son. You see, that letter is also the symbol of spiritual fertility. He says, I'm going to bless your flesh, and you're going to have a son. Friends, he has given us everything we need for life and godliness. We're not just human. We are redeemed. Amen? Abba, Father, we give you praise and we glory and thanksgiving for the things that you have done to redeem us from the corruption of this world. And while I know this has been long, Father, I pray that it has been helpful. And I pray that as they leave this place and go to their home, that everything that was done in this holy place would now take root in their holy homes, at their own tables, in their own lives, as we seek to return lives. And Father, I come to you knowing that there are people in this room who have used their bodies in ways that they are ashamed of. I know that. I know that there are people in here, Father, who understand now that they have willfully used the life within them to do things outside the context of the will and the Word of God. But I pray, Father, right now that the revelation that you would speak to their heart is that's why you sent your Son. So that we could be redeemed not only from the sins we committed unintentionally, but even the ones we did, because there's only one sacrifice for an intentional sin, repentance, the rendering of our hearts. And so, Father, I pray today for anybody in this room that may be struggling with a habitual sin or some behavior or an illicit relationship that needs to end today. And that's not just sexual, Father, verbal abuse, mean-spiritedness, whatever it is, using our flesh to rob the blessing from somebody else's life. Father, I pray we would repent in this place today and recognize that not only is the life you gave to save me holy, but the life that lives in every person I meet is sacred and holy to you, and their lives matter to you, and they should matter to me. May we leave this place to be a blessing, to bring people to fullness and life, and never be used to fan the flame of the curse leading to frustration and death. I end this morning, Father, simply by saying thank you for the cross. Thank you for the tree of death, which was actually a tree of life. Thank you for Yeshua HaMashiach, who came and loved us and gave himself for us and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but through me. I pray that we would begin to draw near, even now, as we continue to worship. Blessed be your name. And all God's children said,
I can't make it on my own, so here I come, running with this song.
I invite you to the altar or to stand and worship,
running
surrender.
Running with this song. And I believe what I can't see. Your love is giving grace to me. So here I come, running with this song. Abba, I run to you, arms open wide, nothing to hide. I can't make it. Running with this song, running with this song. I believe what I can't see. Your love is given grace to me. So here I come, running with this song. I've been here, Lord, a thousand times, with this same war running through my mind. Should I give up or should I just give in? Sometimes it's just too hard to bear, and it's easier if I don't care. But I know for sure your love won't let me go. So Abba, I run to you, arms open wide, nothing to hide. I can't make it on my own, so here I come, running with this song. Running with this song. I believe what I can see. Your love is given grace to me. So here I come, running with this song. Running with this song. I can't make it on my own. Here I come, running with this song. Running with this song. I believe what I can see. Your love is given grace to me. So here I come, running with this song.
Children, come on. Sister Tanya, can you pray over our children?
Abba, these children are so precious in your sight. And we thank you for them, Lord. We pray your blessings upon them. Father, your blessing of peace, your blessing of joy, Father. We thank you for the joy that they bring into our lives. We pray your blessing, God of salvation, and just the knowledge of who you are. We thank you. Thank you, Abba, for each of their lives and their preciousness. I thank you, Father, for the blessings that they are to their families. And we thank you for that, Father. And I thank you that they are being raised in the knowledge of Yeshua, that they are being raised in the knowledge of who you are. And what a blessing that is to them, Father, that your presence, that your ruach would shine through them, Father, even at this young age, Lord, that they would affect everyone they come in contact with, that your glory would shine through their faces, Father, your countenance would rest upon them, Lord. We thank you. We pray this in the name of Yeshua.
Lift your hands to receive the priestly blessing. Yehovah, he who exists, kneel before you presenting gifts and will guard you with a hedge of protection. Yehovah, he who exists, will illuminate the wholeness of his being towards you, bringing order, and he will provide you with love, sustenance, and friendship. And Yehovah, he who exists, will lift up wholeness of being and look upon you, and he will set in place all you need to be, both whole and complete. May Yehovah grant all the desires of our hearts, fulfill all our purposes and all our petitions. May Yehovah hear from heaven, quickly answer all our requests, save us in the day of adversity, and in the name of Yeshua the Messiah, defend us from our enemies, from poverty, and from bondage. Shabbat shalom, everyone. See you in the fellowship hall for some good fellowship and some good food.